I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We welcome you to this service today, and we pray that God is going to be with us, is going to bless you where you are, even as we lead you in worship and praise of his name. I'd like you to open Psalms 121, God, the help of those who seek him. And the word of God says, I lift up my eyes to the hills, from whence comes my help. My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we humble ourselves before you this Lord's Day that you have brought us together to worship you, to give glory to your holy name, and to thank you for the many things that you have done for us. We thank you for preserving us in the midst of many calamities, in the midst of great challenges that face us and the world today. Thy heart has been with us. You have been gracious to us. And we are privileged and honored to be alive and well and to be before you. How we pray, Lord, that the praises that we shall bring to you, the prayers that we shall bring to you, the supplications, Lord, we pray that they will be acceptable to you. I thank you, God, for this team that you have given us to lead this service. I pray that you shall use us as instruments of honor. I remember those who are watching us and following us in various places in this country and in the world where they are. May you remember each one of them and touch them, Lord. We pray that this service honors and glorifies you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Be ready to sing, and I welcome the praise and worship team to lead us.
Amen. Praise the Lord, church. It is a beautiful morning that the Lord has given us, that we may rejoice and be glad in him. We're going to sing a song that says, Akonami. During this pandemic, I know we are worried and we are anxious, but I come to tell you that the Lord is with us. He says that he'll never leave us nor forsake us. So join us even as we sing this song. Amen. Protecting me. Through your power, I am mighty against the weapons formed against me. I shall not fear. I
shall not be. Nimwogope, nimwogope nani, naye Mungu ako nami. Nimwogope nani, naye Mungu ako
the glory, Lord. There is none like you. Blessed be your name. This time we're going to sing a song that says, Mfalme Mwema. Hakuna mwingine kama wewe. Nwe ambaye anastahili, nwe ambaye ni muweza yote. Na tunakupa sifa na utukufu, maana umetukuka. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh. Hallelujah. We give you all the glory. Mfalme mwema, mwaminifu, Baba, mweza yote, una nguvu, haushindwi, pokea. Mfalme mwema, mwaminifu,
mwaminifu,
wewe ni
pokea. Wewe Baba
Mtakatifu
Mwana
Mwana
Wa majeshi
Wa majeshi
O dunia yote
Dunia yote
Imejawa
Imejawa
Na utukufu
Na
utukufu wako Imba tena mtakatifu Takatifu,
takatifu,
oh ni Bwana,
Bwana,
wa majeshi,
wa majeshi,
dunia yote,
dunia yote,
imejawa,
imejawa,
na utukufu,
na
utukufu, imba twakupa, twakupa.
Yes, indeed, we praise the name of the Lord. He alone is worthy to be praised and to be worshipped. As we come in intercessory prayers, I want to ask you, wherever you are, you may have a matter that you would wish to bring before the Lord. This is the opportunity as we pray. Pray in your heart concerning that matter that you want to bring before the Lord. Shall we pray together? Heavenly Father, we come before you. We are a people that forget easily. And many are the times, Lord, that we forget where you have taken us from. And as the singer sang, count your blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Indeed, you have done great things, O Lord. And this morning we humble ourselves, praying that where we have sinned against you, that you may forgive us. We pray that you may help us, O Lord, in the difficulties that we are going through, and sometimes having unbelief concerning that which we face. There are some of us who have brought prayers before you many times concerning our families, concerning the people we love, concerning things that don't make sense, and they are in our lives. And Lord, I want to pray for such a person wherever they are, Lord, that you may reassure them of your love and of your care. And that, God, because we believe that you hear and you answer prayer, it is our prayer that you may hearken to the cry of your people. Lord, in our midst, there are those that are going through pain, the pain of losing a loved one from whatever cause, whether COVID-19 or other diseases. Lord, we are aware in our congregation of Kahawa West that we have people who are mourning, who have been left by their loved ones, by their parents, by their grandparents. Lord, we want to bring this before you specially because you know them, that you may touch them and that you may comfort them, Lord, during this time of grief. And even in our own country and in various places, people watching us at home, some of them may be going through grief. Holy Spirit, you are the comforter. May you comfort them. May you touch them. May you give them strength. And may you give them joy in their heart. Heavenly Father, we thank you for our nation. We thank you for the leadership that you have put in place in authority in this land of Kenya. Lord, we pray that you may endow them with wisdom even as they make very difficult decisions, Lord. We look up to them concerning managing the affairs of this land, and especially the challenges of COVID-19 pandemic, being able to know how to balance lives and livelihoods, when to reopen schools. Oh Lord, how we pray that you may give wisdom to our president and those who rule with him. Ultimately, we look up to him concerning this matter, and we pray that you may be with him, Lord, and that he may choose to do the hard right rather than the easy wrong. But only you know what lies ahead. Father, we pray that you may help our president, that you may help the leadership of our country. Even as we remember the Church of Jesus Christ, Lord, in these days when we are not assembling, we have not been assembling ourselves together because of the challenges of the pandemic, Father, we pray for the church, the church, the people, you who you have called out, that wherever we are, wherever they are, the Lord, you may be with them. We pray for the church leadership as we think about how to come back together into the worship places, how we pray, the Lord, you may lead us, you may guide us. We want to be a responsible church. And so, God, Jesus, you say that you will build your church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so we pray that the church may emerge stronger even from this pandemic that we face. Lord, we thank you and we praise your holy name. Be with us through this service. Glorify yourself, Lord, and let your people have faith. Those who have fear, Lord, may you help them to have faith in you. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. We'll have a song as we wait to read scripture and to hear God's word.
Amen. We're going to sing a song that says, "Before the throne of God above," and I believe we're going to be blessed together.
Of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me.
Can be
Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sins. Because the sinless Savior, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Beholding there the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness.
Wonderful hymn. Would you open your Bible to the book of Hebrews, chapter number 12? Hebrews chapter 12. I will read from verse 1 to verse 11. And as we read this scripture, we are going to be preaching on a topic, looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus. Shall we read together? Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with his sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed, for a few days, chastened us as seemed best to them. But he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. The name of the Lord be praised. So, looking unto Jesus, and I want you to look at verse number 12, which is our lead verse for today. Verse 12, verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And I want to ask you a question today. In your life, who do you look up to? Who do you look up to in your life? When you consider how our families are set up, children look up to their parents. Children look up to their parents. And as a parent, you must be very careful how you respond to children, because they look up to you. Even when sometimes you may not, as a parent, be able to know how you will put a square meal on the table, the children go on with their life expecting when it is time to have a meal, it will be there. Children look up to their parents. And I urge the parents to be careful how you answer your children, because they look up to you. And if they lose faith in you, where else would they go? Employees look up to employers for their livelihoods. As employers, and I am one, we have to scratch our heads many times to know, even during these difficult times of COVID-19, when businesses are low, when the normal revenues that you'd expect from the businesses that we do are not there, and for some reason, the employee at the end of the month is looking up to you and expecting to be paid something to keep their livelihoods. So employees look up to employers. Pupils look up to their teacher for answers to difficult mathematic questions or whatever subject. A pupil will be expecting that the teacher has the answer. And there are many times that the teacher may not have the answer. And some teachers are very clever. When they don't have the answer, they may tell the pupils, I give you homework to do some research. And then when we come back, and so the pupils think that the teacher knows, so they go and do research, as the teacher is also doing research. And so the pupils look up to teacher. A teacher must get their act together. Apostle James, in James chapter 3 and verse 1, has spoken very directly to teachers. And he says, "My brethren, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment." Being a teacher puts you in a very responsible position. Whether you are a teacher in a primary school, in a high school, in a university, or you are a teacher of the Word of God, like I am preaching and teaching today. As I preach this message and others, I am conscious of the fact that God holds me accountable for what I teach, for what I say. And in that chapter where James was speaking about teachers, it is a chapter that talks about the tongue, how the tongue can inflame a whole forest. And therefore, pupils look up to teachers. And those teachers may be in the church, they may be in the school, they may be even in life. We can also be students of those we look up to in our professions and in our daily lives. We must know that there are those who look up to us. In this day and age of information age, where there is social media, there are people who are followed by others. And those who follow, they say, I follow so and so. They look up to that person. And if that person led them in the wrong way, so you need to be responsible. There's a little poem I remember I read when I was a little younger. It talks about the little fellow who follows you. You must know that there's a little fellow who follows you. You may not see them, but they are behind. You take a corner and they see. And you know what? They follow you. You take a wrong corner and lead them in the wrong direction. The little fellow who follows you may either lose confidence when they come to know, and from there henceforth, they lose. So, who do you look up to? Who do you look up to? As a nation, as a people, in our country, at a time such as this, we look up to our leaders. We look up to our president, for example. There are difficult decisions to be taken concerning whether to reopen schools or not to reopen schools because of COVID, what to do, when to open places of worship, when to reopen what. As a nation, we look up to our leader and so forth. And as a country, as a world, there has been a debate about lacking mentors in life. There are many people who would like mentors, and they don't get. As Christians, who do we look up to? The Hebrews writer, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, begins, and it's a continuation from chapter 11, by saying, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. You know, the writer here, he makes us aware that we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. He makes us aware that we are on a race. And on this race, there are people watching us. There is a crowd of people who have already finished the race with honor. In Hebrews 11, which is a role of honor of men and women who ran their race, a man like Abraham, a man like Noah, a man like Enoch. Hebrews 11 is a role of honor of men and women who finished their race in honor. And 12 comes, and therefore we also. So this is a crowd of people who have already finished the race with honors. These people who have finished their race are those who are enumerated. For example, there's a man called Abraham, and there's a little Sunday school song that I remember to date about Abraham. When I think about a man like Abraham, who was told to sacrifice his only son, and this he did without complaining, and so he became afraid of God. It's not easy. Abraham, after waiting for so many years, he got a son, and then he's told by God to sacrifice that only son. Oh, and he did, even though God provided an alternative sacrifice. What about Noah, who was told to build an ark, and people were mocking him? By then, rain was not known, and Noah was saying there is going to be rain, and people had not seen rain, and they were mocking him. And I remember, even when COVID-19 started way back in January in Wuhan, and we were talking about it, some of us who have a little knowledge on health, nobody could listen. Nobody was thinking that it is something that could come to their country. But for Noah, it was 120 years that he was building this ark. So their example should encourage us to run our race. They did not have it easy. That is the point. They faced many challenges. For us to make it, Scripture urges us to do three things. If you are going to make in this race, and the writer of Hebrews here is helping us to see that like life is a race. And what is your race? Each one of us is on a race. But let us look at these people in the past who ran a race with honor. It wasn't easy. And the writer here encourages us and inspires us to do several things. Number one, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, kina Abraham, kina Enoch, let us lay aside every weight. So one of the things that we have been asked to do is to lay aside every weight, every burden. And the writer here takes the analogy of a race. When you think about people who run, when they go on an Olympic, like when Kipchoge was going to break the marathon record, look at the way he wore. Look at the kind of shoes he wore. Surely the way I am dressed, I really cannot go to the field this way. If I want to run, even a simple cross-country run, I would need to remove my jacket off. I would need to remove this shirt on and wear a lighter garment. I would need to remove and wear a short garment and to remove the shoes I'm wearing and wear sports shoes. So the writer here compares our life journey as a race and says, let us lay aside. So what are these burdens that we need to put aside so that we can run this race and win like the men of old? One of them I want to suggest is mentioned in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 38 and 39, and I want you to go back. One of the things that we need to lay aside if we are to run this race and win, verse 38 and 39 of Hebrews chapter 10. Now, the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. So, we are not of those who fear. Here, one of the issues we need to put aside is fear. And many of us have a lot of fears, even concerning the times we are. And fear is the opposite of faith. If you have faith, you have no reason to fear. But if you lose faith, you begin to fear. And so, we must put aside fear. Because when we fear, we are not able to run. Even going to the field, if you are going to break a record, if you are going to play, I used to be a player of lawn tennis. If you have your opposite number and you think he's better than you, you will not be able to play. But if you have courage, you will fight the battle and win. And so, one of the burdens that we need to lay aside is fear. Number two, I want to suggest, is written in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 15. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse number 15. The word of God says, Hebrews 10, 15, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are sanctified. I want to change that. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 15. The word of God says, looking diligently, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled. Looking diligently, lest any one fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness. Bitterness can defile others and bring doubt. And some of us are living bitter lives. Some of us are bitter. They are bitter with everything. Some of us are even bitter with God. Some of us are bitter with the things that are going on. Even when God blesses us with rain, never mind that the floods will come, some people become bitter. Look at the people in your life. If you keep the company of people who are bitter, this is likely to be a source of discouragement even for you in running your race. So, one of the things that we need to lay aside is bitterness. The other one, number three, is in Hebrews 12 and verse 16. The verse that follows there. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. Sensuality that seeks immediate gratification. Sensuality that seeks immediate gratification. This is a matter that we need to lay aside if we are going to run a race and win. So, those are three things that I suggest we need to put aside, and the word of God brings. One of them, laying aside every weight, that the burdens that we need to put off, and one of them is fear. The other one is bitter discouragement, and the other one is sensuality. And in your life, you know, the Bible says that without holiness, no one will see God. These are things that you need to put aside. Sensuality. And what else do you need to put off? The Bible says that bad company ruins good morals. What you watch in social media, what you watch, you know, in this day and age where there are so many things that are being posted around to you, you need to sense, is this something that I want to read? Is it something that I want to pass on to somebody else? Is this what I want to watch? It's a decision you have to make if you're going to win. So what are these other things? I will not finish for you. Look at your life and see. Put this off. These burdens, lay them aside. And then, so one of the things is lay aside every weight. And we have suggested three things. And you can add onto them. The other one, number two, is look up to Jesus. Look up to Jesus. You know, the word of God here is telling us that there are a crowd of witnesses, those who have gone before us, they inspire us. But our principal encouragement is found in the person of Jesus Christ, who has gone before us as the author and the perfecter of our faith. He is the supreme example in the race. And the Bible says that for the joy that was set before him, Jesus endured the cross in anticipation of the joy of being the savior of his people. He endured, you know, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross. I think Jesus Christ, because he came from heaven, he was sent here for a purpose, to save his people. And because he knew the ultimate was to be the savior, the challenge of going through pain was nothing compared to what he was to become. Scripture repeatedly say it was necessary that Christ was to suffer. And to finish, just to put it, exactly what Jesus had to do, I want to read Philippians chapter 2 and verse 5 to 11. Philippians 2, verse 5 to 11. The Bible says, let this might be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bond servant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that as the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So, Jesus is our example. So, as Christians, who do you look up to? We are surrounded by a great crowd of witnesses, of men and women who made it. Even Brother Paul went through a lot of troubles. I was reading Acts chapter 27, his voyage from Caesarea to Rome. A lot of trouble. But God encouraged him, and he was looking forward to go to Rome. He knew he was going to go to Rome. And even for us Christians, you know what? We know that God has promised us eternal life when we make it. So, what are we to do? Lay aside every weight. Examine your life. Repent of every sin. Put those things aside that prevent you from running the race. Number two, run your race with endurance. It's not easy. God did not promise us an easy run. Life is not easy, but God has promised to be with us. There's a verse I love where Jesus said, in this world you have many tribulations, but be of good cheer, I have overcome. Number three, look up to Jesus, the author and perfecter of your faith. May the Lord bless you and help you to examine yourself and you see what you can lay aside. Because God is with us and we shall make it as those men of old also made it. Shall we pray? Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for encouraging us to look up to you, Jesus, and to also reflect and see how you are with people like Abraham, like Paul, and those who have gone before us. Some of them, we know them in our own lives, and they ran a good race. May you help us to run our race this day, looking up to you, Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of our faith. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much. As we drive towards the end of the service, it is another time that we have opportunity to give our tithes and offerings to the work of the Lord. And we urge you to use the number that is on the screen. It's an M-Pesa pay bill number. Just put, when you come to account, you can say either it's an offering or it's a tithe. And I also want to thank many, many people in our church who have brought food to the church to be given to those who need. We encourage you to continue doing so. Every day of the week, there's someone in the office. There's a team that is distributing this food, and they have been very faithful. Let us be counted as people who shared what we had with those who are in need during the pandemic. The Lord bless you.
Amen. Just as I've been told, we are going to give. And even as we give, I believe the Lord has been faithful to you. Day after day, He has provided. And so even as we give what the Lord has given us, may you be blessed.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God.